We are now going to learn to compare the means from several groups using the OneWay ANOVA in JASP. For this example, we are going to create our dataset in Excel, import those data into JASP, and learn some new JASP data skills along the way. Here is the research story for our OneWay ANOVA. Following a series of complaints about wicked witches, the Wizard of Oz conducts a study to determine if certain regions of Oz have more problems with wicked witches than other regions. He randomly surveys 5 munchkins from each of the 4 regions and records the number of complaints that he receives about wicked witchiness from each one. Is there a difference in witch wickedness between regions? Let's start by entering our data. Let's begin by looking at the data in the CSV. Notice that we have 2 columns. The first column, labeled region, is a series of 1, 2, 3, and 4, indicating each of the 4 regions. We would call this type of variable a factor. We will attach labels to each of these regions in JASP. The second column, labeled complaints, contains the data from each of the 4 regions entered in order within a single column. The first 5 individual complaints were from the north region, which is 1. The second 5 are from the south region, which is 2. The third 5 are from the east region, which is 3. And the last 5 are from the west region, which is 4. The data have been saved as wickedwitch.csv, and we are ready to begin. Begin by placing the dataset wickedwitch.csv on your computer desktop. We open our dataset by clicking in the upper left corner on the main menu icon and then selecting Open, Computer, Desktop, wickedwitch.csv, and then clicking Open. Let's look at our data. The variables have imported, but we need to make some changes. Region is a categorical or nominal variable. On the left edge of the box, we can click here to change column type. Set it to nominal. Because this nominal variable is a factor, we should add the names of the regions where the witches live. Hover over the name of the variable. Click here to change labels. For region, label 1 as north, 2 as south, 3 as east, and 4 as west. For the scale variable complaints, we can click here to change column type. Set it to scale. Those are all of the changes, so now we are ready to do the analysis. You will conduct a one-way ANOVA by going to ANOVA, ANOVA. That was easy, right? Next, we will move our variables into place. Notice how JASP tells us what kinds of variables should go in each box. Our dependent variable, the variable that measures something, is the scale variable, number of complaints. And our fixed factor is the categorical variable, the factor region. JASP uses progressive disclosure, so as soon as our variables are in place, we see the results of the ANOVA. It looks like our p is less than 0.05. In fact, it is less than 0.001, meaning that our ANOVA is significant. But before we do anything else, before we interpret the ANOVA, we should first check the assumptions of the ANOVA test. Click on Assumptions Checks. As with the independent samples t-test, one of our assumptions for a one-way ANOVA is that we have equal variances in each of the 4 groups, or regions. This is the assumption of homogeneity of variance, and we check it with the box for homogeneity tests. We immediately see the Levine's test, which is used to test the assumption of homogeneity of variance. Because we would prefer that the groups have equal variance, that the regions are not different in their variance, we would prefer that the Levine's test be non-significant, indicating that there are no significant differences in variability between the groups. We see here that the Levine's test is not even close to significance, p equals 0.918, which is great. Because the Levine statistic is not significant, the variability within the groups is not statistically significantly different. This is what we want. This matches our assumption that the groups have equal or homogeneous variance. If, however, the assumption of homogeneity of variances was violated, if Levine's test was significant, less than 0.01, or better yet, less than 0.001, then we could correct for that using a homogeneity correction. We would use either the Welch's ANOVA or the Brown-Forsyth test, and then interpret any significant findings using the Gaimes-Howell Posthoc. So how do you decide between Welch's and Brown-Forsyth? I will need to make another video addressing those differences, but for now, the short answer is to just use the Welch's test in most cases. Although, in this particular case, I would use the Brown-Forsyth if the assumption of homogeneity of variances was violated, only because the sample size is so small, less than 6. However, we now know that the assumption of homogeneity of variances has been met. So we do not need these homogeneity corrections, and we do not need Gaimes-Howell. We will deselect them. We can also check the QQ plot of the residuals. I cover the details about this test in a different lecture, but for now, we just want to make sure that all of the dots are on the line or really close to the line. And they are. The dots almost always get off of the line at the far ends, but all of the dots in the center are very close to the line. So that assumption has been met too. When we look at the F table, specifically the small p-value, we know that our one-way ANOVA is statistically significant. Our p-value is less than 0.001. You never report significance as p equals 0.000, because the probability is not really zero. It may be really small, but it is never actually zero. Instead, you would report p less than 0.001. There are statistically significant differences among the groups. The problem is, we do not know which groups are different. And for that, we need a post-hoc test. Click on Post-hoc Tests. Move over Regions to indicate that this is the factor for which we need a post-hoc test. By default, we get Tukey for our post-hoc. We could choose any of the other options if we so desired. We're going to stick with Tukey because each region has the same number of participants, or munchkins. Let's also get the confidence intervals to help with our interpretation later. This is where we would select the Gaimes-Howell post-hoc if the assumptions had been violated. And remember that you only need a post-hoc or a follow-up test when the ANOVA is significant. If it is not significant, then there are no significant differences among the groups. No need for a post-hoc. There are no differences to find. Let's get some other useful output. Click on Descriptive Plots. Move regions into the horizontal axis. Scroll down, and we will see a plot of the means. You can display error bars if you like. I always like to start by looking at the plots. Now, to make this easier to see, let's stretch out this graph a little. Now we can read the words better. We can see that there are two lower groups, looks like north and south, and then two higher groups, east, and west. Okay, keep that in mind. Under Additional Options, we will get the descriptive statistics and the estimates of effect size. We will report the eta squared, which will always be exactly the same as the partial eta squared in a one-way ANOVA. The partial eta squared will be smaller in a two-way or a three-way ANOVA. The omega squared effect size will always be smaller than either eta or partial eta. For our purposes, we only need the eta value for effect size. Finally, if we had an ordinal dependent variable, or if the data violated one of the test assumptions so badly that they were not suitable for a parametric test, we could employ the non-parametric alternative Kruskal-Wallis test. In many cases, however, you would still use the Welch's test instead of Kruskal-Wallis when the assumptions were violated. Let's take a look at these results. The significant ANOVA tells us that at least one region is different from one other region. We need a post-hoc to find out which one. In this table of post-hoc results, each region is compared to the other three regions. You can see the mean difference, the standard error of the mean, and the confidence intervals. Any confidence interval that crosses zero, if one is positive and the other is negative, is non-significant. Those groups do not differ. As we saw with the plot, we can see that the north region is not different than the south region, but both of them are different than both the east and west regions. This box contains the descriptive statistics. These are broken down by each region. Here we can see the mean, the standard deviation, and the sample size for each group. Essentially, we have two subsets. North and South are in the same subset of low complaints. East and West are in the same subset, high complaints. The North and South group is statistically significantly different than the East and West group, but the regions within those subsets are not different from each other. Here is how we would write up our results in APA style. For a full write-up, I would mention the test assumptions that were checked. Levine's test was non-significant, indicating that the assumption of homogeneity of variance was not violated. Normality was checked with a QQ plot. No deviations were noted. And then I would go on to the full ANOVA write-up. To interpret and report this ANOVA, we would report the name of the test, F, followed by the degrees of freedom between and within, 3 and 16, and then the F value of 10.49. I report the p-value, the partial eta squared, which is the same as the eta squared for a one-way ANOVA, and you will see that I listed the means and standard deviations for each group. The last statement about the meaning of the findings would go in your discussion section if you were writing this up for a paper. And that is how you do a one-way ANOVA in JASP.